Hey team, I'm Ash Kelly, and this is I Am Madeline, episode 5. It's mid to late July now, and honestly, I'm not sure that Madeline will live to see another December, another Christmas or Hanukkah.
Well, Halloween's my favorite, but solstice and yeah, I love the season.
More donations have come into her GoFundMe, a few thousand more dollars. It will take her all the way to August, but then we don't know what will happen. And last Christmas, COVID 2020 wasn't the best, especially for people with immune deficiencies, chronic illnesses. Madeline recorded this just ahead of the 2020 holidays.
I don't know, but I feel so isolated. And it's really hard not to have anything to look forward to for Christmas. Like, nothing. And I know it's my birthday around then, too. It's really kind of doing my head in.
Christmas is usually the time of year Madeline is able to spend time with friends and overcome the overwhelming isolation that chronic illness brings.
I get to see them. I get to hear what's going on. We get to do fun things. Like some of my friends, we have a tradition of watching that stopgap animation of like Frosty and Rudolph and all those. Like, and I get to be a part of that. People want to see me. I still feel like I'm part of the world. I enjoy doing it, but B, sometimes, yes, there's a brutality in sort of forcing myself through the pain and fatigue to do it. But you don't get to keep friends if you're not there for them when they need it, or you're not there with them to celebrate.
So today I want to kind of pull on the threads of the holidays as a theme for this episode, a sort of Christmas in July for Madeline and for any of us who need to feel the spirit of the holidays right now. Madeline grew up in a rather unsafe home, and so the kind of love and comfort she couldn't get from her parents, she found in Santa Claus.
Santa for me was somebody who loved me, somebody who took the time to get me presents that seemed like they knew who I was. I felt a little bit special on Christmas.
Madeline's very first appearance on stage came at Christmas time in a school play called Santa Goes on Strike, in which Santa takes a leave from Christmas Day because he's overworked and underappreciated.
And you have to understand, I love Santa so much. And yes, a lot of my classmates didn't believe in Santa anymore, but Santa was such an important figure in my life and was pretty much the only person who loved me as far as I could figure out, Santa and Grandma. And of course, I didn't understand how Santa worked, but that was my feeling. So when this play came up, I was actually cast as what they call the lead child. And that role had the most lines. And my best friend at the time, she got cast as Santa Claus. And we left after our casting and I was like, I want to be Santa Claus. And she's like, I want to be the lead child. So we went home and learned each other's lines and came back for the start of rehearsal with sort of a fait accompli of like, we've switched characters. What you gonna do about it? And the teacher kind of laughed and said, okay, that's what you want to do. And boy, did I ever want to do that. And one of the things that it turned out to be quite funny, but well, you see, nobody mentioned to me that this play was a comedy. And because I was so concerned about Santa feeling unappreciated and Santa feeling taken for granted, and because I love Santa so much, I really wanted to do the play justice. So in my mind, this was tragedy. This was like Shakespearean high tragedy. And that's how I played it. So cut to the play, to the performance of the play. And oh my God, the minute I started talking, the audience just erupted in laughter. They just howled. And there was this priest in the front row who a big, jolly laugh that you just couldn't escape. And the more he laughed, the angrier I became. And the angrier I became, the more serious I became. And the more they laughed, and I was horrified. I was incensed. Did nobody else love Santa Claus? Like, here was this person who cared for people and wanted them to feel loved and appreciated, and they were laughing? So jump to after the play, and I'm heading to the car, and I was furious as only a child that age can be, like absolutely incensed. And my family was like, you see, it was a comedy. They were laughing because it was a comedy. They weren't laughing at Santa. I mean, so they're trying to explain this, and I'm looking at them like they've lost all their marbles. And then it occurs to me, was it a comedy? I suppose that was my first method acting. I think ultimately the reason I wanted to play Santa was he had been such a light in the darkness of a lot of my childhood that I felt like I kind of owed it to Santa to do him justice. And I think that that really has been a driving force in the performance work that I've done. And then when I couldn't perform anymore, in the community work that I've done, that the things are very purpose-driven for me.
As we know, Madeline went on to study theater in university, and she moved across the country to follow her dreams of being on stage, but got sick just as things started to take off. Nowadays, Madeline's disease makes it literally impossible for her to work because myalgic encephalomyelitis has destroyed her body's ability to create energy. And when she uses any more than the small amount of energy she does have, her body crashes. She feels like every cell in her body is suffocating. She deteriorates, sometimes permanently, and experiences incredible pain.
I have been forced to work outside my energy envelope, which is happening more and more and more because everything's outside my energy envelope. But like when I first moved into my current apartment, that's a huge expenditure of energy. And for, I want to say, 8 months, I didn't have the strength to get the top off my pharmacy bottles. I was struggling to stand. I couldn't raise my arms above my head. Like the muscle weakness was so profound.
If she were able to work over the last 25 years or so, she would most likely have been acting on stage or film. But Madeline didn't just quit her career or give up trying to find another way to support herself. First, she worked through the pain, but that just made things worse. Then she tried to start her own small business. The BC government has a program that supports entrepreneurs with disabilities. It says being self-employed allows flexible hours and a work environment that is tailored to your individual needs.
So when I was on the intravenous about between 20 and 17 years ago, which I never could afford, I was always hemorrhaging into debt with it, and I was offered an opportunity to do a disability business self-employment course, and I thought, oh, this is how I afford this. But the problem is, if you don't have the supports before you start something like that, then it's always going to fail. So what happened is I was seeing a naturopath back then who was giving me he wasn't earning any money on me at all. At that time, they did have 12 visits a year that were covered at the governing body rates, so he was at least getting something. But they took that away. And I knew he didn't want to be my naturopath anymore. I knew he didn't want to. And it's really hard to know that. He sort of foisted me off on an intern, and then that intern became a partner, and he sort of became a bit more of a primary, and he decided to go out in private practice. And he said, "Do you want to come with me?" And I was like, "Okay." He said, "I'll keep everything the same, like the same price, the same treatment. The original naturopath had offered me to carry a debt with him, which is nice of him, but so anyway, I went with this other naturopath who, in short order, more than doubled the price of the treatment and then ceased to do the treatment at all.
Madeline even bought a business license and held on to it year after year.
But the hard thing is that business advisor at that course, he said, "You are such an impressive person." And I don't mean this as a stroke my ego. He meant that as in a brutally practical, "I would have you charge $1,000 a session for what you're doing because you are so knowledgeable and you are so impressive." So I had the real possibility of of, you know, being able to take care of myself a little better. But you can't do that without the basics. If the basic, it costs more to work if you're disabled. You must have the basics taken care of. So I held on to that. I held that business license for like 15 years. I was determined to do it. I'm wasting money every year on it because I so wanted to do it. And
the thing about ME is that working often makes you sicker because all jobs take some level of energy to do. So doctors here at the Complex Chronic Diseases Program in Vancouver tell patients that they need to hire house cleaners, get pre-made meals delivered, because groceries, prepping food and cooking and then eating it can be far too much energy, too much of a drain on their bodies. And that means they can't do the other things that they're being asked to do, like move around, go for an occasional walk, see friends, and avoid social isolation. But all those things that save people with ME energy cost them money. There are those who are unable to work, and then others who find themselves facing discrimination from employers. A lot of people in Madeline's position end up on government disability assistance, a monthly stipend usually doled out by a provincial ministry in charge of welfare programming. And that amount is typically higher for people with disabilities receiving assistance than people who are considered able to work. But the tools we use to assess the cost of living and determine the so-called poverty line don't account for the increased costs people with disabilities face, like medical devices, medicine, doctor's notes, assistance at home, specialty diets, or having to get to and from endless appointments.
You know, when you give a PWD money, it's an economic stimulus. It isn't like, oh, we're just giving them money. This money is a river. It flows. I mean, we need to spend it on more things than a healthy person, you know, so it goes out faster.
Poor people are getting sicker, mentally and physically, and cannot afford to get better. They end up stuck on government assistance and stuck in poverty. Madeline just wants to survive, but to do that, she needs the kind of help that doesn't fit neatly into the little boxes that government applications make her check off.
Making us ask for every little thing, not only is it humiliating and impossible in an Everest, it's also bloody expensive and doesn't make any sense that you're calling in and you're getting a different person every time, that you have to fill out paperwork that you're not up for, that you don't know how to fill out. Doctors are being asked to fill in this paperwork and not being paid to do so. And so it creates this discrimination cycle around them not being paid. Then they don't want PWD on assistance patients. And they will actively tell us no, make up reasons because it's illegal just to say no to us.
Remember Alet Mansky from episode 3? He's a longtime advocate and ally who's been lobbying the government for a guaranteed income for people with disability most of the year now. His opinion is that the way disability assistance is set up is still based on laws that governed how poverty was managed in Elizabethan and Victorian times.
The income support comes through a welfare system that goes back to the Elizabethan times, to the Elizabethan poor laws. It's still, those assumptions are still in our welfare system that you're a cheat. You should only be on for a short period of time. If we're going to give you anything, you must report in, etc.
These systems often claw back payments over a minimal amount, especially if people have savings or assets to their name. The idea is that people with disabilities don't receive assistance until it's a last resort. He says BC in particular, however, has made it easier for some people with disabilities to hold on to pre-existing wealth.
Waiving of assets, you know, the asset limitation is very high here. There are people who have assets in their registered disability savings plan now that, you know, are getting close to $200,000, and they're still eligible for disability benefits. So those kinds of chains are being broken. So it's simply seen as a basic income support for people with disabilities so they can go out and make their contribution, whether it's the contribution that the economy accepts or whether it's the other contributions that we can't do without because that's what makes society function. So I think we're moving in that direction, and the federal government's commitment to a Canada Disability Benefit, I think, is the opportunity to actually do this on the grandest scale imaginable. I put this at the level of Medicare or PharmaCare. It's the biggest gap in our social welfare net. We have a chance to remedy that, but it's going to take all Canadians recognizing that this is an outstanding issue.
Edmansky is not alone. Critics, experts, leading economists, and people living on government income say the system we have right now is failing them. John Stapleton is one of those critics. He worked for the Ontario government's Ministry of Community and Social Services for nearly 30 years, and he's long talked about the so-called welfarization of disability income supports. This was from a speaking event back in 2012 titled, People with Disabilities Living in Poverty, Why Are the Numbers Going Up?
Now, I have an anecdote here, and really what's part of what started me into this work, and that was my 89-year-old mother. I was doing Meals on Wheels with her at Wood Green Community Center, and she says, you're supposed to be smart about those these programs. I have a friend, she's on disability, and she thinks she's getting the wrong amount. And I said, well, I'd have to know what disability program she's on. And she said, oh, there you go, complicating things again. And so it got me to thinking. She assumed that there was a coherent system out there of disability programs because she didn't really face them. And of course, what happened is that she realized that. So it got me to thinking about how many programs are there actually. And there's actually 8 different disability, not disability income programs, but disability income systems in Canada. We have EI sickness, CPP disability, veterans programs, private plans, workers' compensation, social assistance, disability tax credits, DTC, and now we have a new one called the RDSP. So we have 8 disability income systems. So I wasn't smart enough that day to say, which of the 8 are you talking about? I had to actually think about it and build up an inventory of them. So here's an interesting point that when 5 of 8 of those programs, 5 of them, are only available to people who have engaged in regular salaried or wage-paid work. So you have to work. So it has to be a later-onset disability that you get. And it has to be a disability that you only get after you have worked in the labor force and you were salaried or a wage-paid worker.
Since the pandemic began, Stapleton has been trying to convince the federal government that its benefits program, the Canada Emergency Response Benefit, or CERB, rolled out during the pandemic, is such a mess that it's actually causing serious financial harm to disabled and poor people. When the pandemic began, the Canadian government quickly implemented CERB, a $2,000 a month guaranteed income for Canadians who had suddenly lost their jobs. It was meant to help performers as theaters closed, servers and cooks as restaurants closed, and those in tourism, fitness, and other industries impacted by government shutdowns. Every person who enrolled almost immediately received nearly twice that of a single person on disability assistance. In total, the federal government has thrown around $80 billion at the program, which suddenly accounted for about a third of all Canada's social assistance expenditures. Provinces in charge of social assistance told about 2 million Canadians to apply for the federal CERB program, just in case they were eligible. And some provinces told people they wouldn't be eligible for provincial emergency packages unless they applied for CERB. And the feds, in turn, doled it out to almost everyone who applied, as the system became overwhelmed. But within months, the Liberals announced they believed more than 200,000 people had wrongly received the benefit. They would be clawing back any payments made to those deemed to be ineligible. The government even tabled a bill promising massive fines and jail time for anyone caught cheating the system. The chest puffing came after the Conservative Party of Canada had gone on a media campaign railing against the Liberals' CERB program and how disastrously it had been managed in their view. Here's former Conservative leader Andrew Scheer in the House of Commons.
The Conservatives agree that those who need help should get it, and no one is arguing that they shouldn't. But reports indicate that the Liberals have ordered public servants to turn a blind eye to 200,000 cases of suspected fraud. So, simple question, yes or no, did the government instruct any government department to ignore red flags or warnings of fraudulent cases? Yes or no?
The Right Honourable Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, the priority in this situation was getting money out to the millions of Canadians who needed it as quickly as possible. But of course, fraud is unacceptable. That's why we have met and put safeguards in place to ensure that anyone who received that money fraudulently will have to repay it.
News organizations across this country aired the political theater, but rarely addressed the fact that little to no fraud had actually been uncovered. They rarely addressed the level of confusion and mismanagement between levels of government that led to ineligible people receiving the benefit. A now deleted tweet from the right-wing anti-tax organization, the Canadian Taxpayers Federation, suggested erroneously that some people had been signing their horses up for CERB and double-dipping the system. And once again, this idea that social assistance programs like CERB, like disability assistance and welfare, invariably attract fraudsters, malingering, lazy layabouts who just don't want to work, was spread across the front page and headlining every morning show in the country for days. Critics raised serious concerns that the fraud narrative was political, would punish the poor, and that there was actually relatively little fraud going on. Then the government set up a snitch hotline for people to report on CERB fraudsters. On Christmas Day last year, 2020, John Stapleton tried to reason with the Federal Minister for Employment, Workforce Development, and Disability Inclusion, Carla Qualtro. He wrote her a letter saying that repatriating the money from the small number of people who applied in good faith but were confused by the thresholds for eligibility were victims of miscommunication from the government, and actions against them would disproportionately hurt the most poor working people in Canada, those who made less than or just over $17,000 a year. In this Christmas Day letter to Minister Qualtro, Stapleton says the government's clawbacks will hobble the poor for years to come, all because of misinformation, stigma, and a badly designed program. And he invokes the Dickensian character of Ebenezer Scrooge, writing about the miser's overnight change of heart that saw him repent from his greedy ways and even come to love the poor people around him. Stapleton writes, quote, "Dickens' character Scrooge tells Bob Cratchit on Christmas morning that he has not lost his senses, rather that he's come to them. Fortunately, there is still time for you to put an end to the misery of thousands of very low-income people ensnared in an unfortunate set of rules where there was no time to think through the unintended consequences of policy." But Scrooge didn't just suddenly come to his senses. First, he had to go through the horrifying experience of facing his own mortality, seeing for the first time the impacts of his cruelty. Only then did he accept how he had grown wealthy on the backs of others who were suffering under oppressive poverty and low wages, and how the disabled and ill were often rendered helpless when it came to lifting themselves out of the depths of that despair. In Scrooge and Dickens' time, poverty and disability were almost universally criminalized. Madeline actually used Scrooge as an example of how she felt treated by the government months before we settled on this theme for this episode.
You know, I have thought a lot about the whole, you know, like Scrooge said, you know, why not just die and decrease the population? Is that what my country believes should happen to me?
She's referencing an early scene in Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Two men appear at Scrooge's door asking for donations for the poor. This is how Scrooge replies in the 1999 television adaptation starring Patrick Stewart.
"You will agree, I'm sure, that many thousands of people lack the basic necessities, and many hundreds of thousands lack ordinary comforts."
"Are there no prisons?"
"Plenty of prisons, sir."
"And the union workhouses, are they still in operation?"
Yes, they are. I only wish I could say they were not."
"I support those institutions I have mentioned, and I expect the poor to make use of them. Those who are badly off must go there."
"Many cannot go there, and many would rather die."
"They'd rather die. They'd better do it and decrease the surplus population."
This is the kind of attitude a lot of people still have about the poor and health challenged. Scrooge eventually comes around, but only after a frightening visit from the ghosts of Christmas past, Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmas yet to come. In those visits, Scrooge sees how his selfishness will lead to the death of the son of his beleaguered employee, Bob Cratchit. Tiny Timothy Cratchit was ill, and his family was unable to afford his treatments. "Unless Scrooge changes his ways," says the spirit of Christmas present, "the boy will die." Here's some of that scene from the 1984 film.
"A Merry Christmas to us
all. And God bless us, everyone."
Invisible to the family, Scrooge watches on as the Cratchits enjoy their meager Christmas dinner with gratitude.
"Tell me, spirit, will he live?"
"I see a vacant place at this table. I see a crutch without an owner, carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, the child will die."
"No. No, say he will be spared."
"If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, none other of my species will find him here. But if he is to die, then let him die. and decrease the surplus population.
You use my own words against me.
So perhaps in the future you will hold your tongue until you have discovered what the surplus population is and where it is. It may well be that in the sight of heaven you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this poor man's child.
It's at this point that Scrooge starts to understand the value of human life, and that wealth and physical ability have no bearing on such a measure. Then the ghastly, death-like spirit of Christmas yet to come shows Scrooge how his own death would go mostly unmarked, himself wholly unremembered and uncelebrated given his greed and selfishness. And he's broken, to the point of full redemption. On Christmas Day, Ebenezer Scrooge awakens with a new, thankful heart in a Muppet's Christmas Carol.
Here's your turkey, Mr. Scrooge.
Follow me, lad.
With a thankful heart, with an endless joy, with a growing family, every girl and boy will be nephew and niece to me.
Nephew and niece to me.
Will bring love, hope, and peace to me.
Love, hope, and peace to me.
Yes, and every night will end, and every day will start with a grateful prayer and a thankful heart. With an open smile and with open doors, I will bid you welcome. What is mine is yours. With a glass raised to toast your health.
With a glass raised to toast your health.
And a promise to share the wealth.
Promise to share the wealth.
I will sail a friendly course, file a friendly charm. On a sea of love and a thankful heart.
With A Christmas Carol, Dickens not only captures the brutality of Victorian policy and stigma against the poor, but the story continues to challenge our current assumptions about poverty. He used his pen to wage a war for the poor. In fact, A Christmas Carol was originally going to be published as a political pamphlet titled An Appeal to the People of England on Behalf of the Poor. Dickens' anti-poverty advocacy was likely brought on after he himself was thrown into indentured labor at 12 years old in the middle of the Industrial Revolution because his family had gone bankrupt. Dickens' father, mother, and siblings were sent to a debtor's prison, but he was sent to a shoe polish factory to work 10-hour days in a dark room, gluing labels to bottles. This is what the Elizabethan poor laws that Itmansky says our current welfare system stems from looked like in practice. Families in prison, child labor, police brutality, and for those considered sick or injured enough they truly couldn't work, they were sent to poorhouses, where they would be isolated from society, removed from their families, and often suffer abuses. By the time Charles Dickens began writing A Christmas Carol, he was a young man, and new Victorian poor laws had come into effect, shifting away from having churches administer issues of poverty to a broader model of having the state jail and beat beggars and punish the bankrupt. Public discourse centered mostly on the burden that the poor had on higher classes of landowners and wealthy estate-owning families who did pay taxes. The idea of an idle, morally corrupt class of poor people came from the disdain of the upper class, who had never known hardship. And these anti-taxation sentiments are still some of the go-to partisan right-wing arguments against increasing disability payments or providing a universal basic income. The question is always, how will the government pay for these programs, and should they pay to keep people out of poverty? In response, progressive economists have pointed to the massive issues of tax evasion by billionaires and corporations. Because if it's a drain on taxes and the public dollars we're most worried about, if it's a scarcity in government coffers that has working class people worried the poor will drain the budget, then aren't we missing the point? Dutch historian Rutger Bregman is the author of Utopia for Realists, How We Can Build the Ideal World, and Humankind, A Hopeful History. But he became much more widely known after giving a lecture to world leaders at the World Economic Forum in Davos in 2019.
This is my first time at Davos, and I find it quite a bewildering experience, to be honest. I mean, 1,500 private jets have flown in here to hear Sir David Attenborough speak about, you know, how we're wrecking the planet. And I mean, I hear people talk in the language of participation and justice and equality and transparency. But then, I mean, almost no one raises the real issue of tax avoidance, right? And of the rich just not paying their fair share. I mean, it feels like I'm at a firefighters conference and no one's allowed to speak about water. I mean, this is not rocket science. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can talk for a very long time about all these stupid philanthropy schemes. We can invite Bono once more, but come on, we got to be talking about taxes. Yeah, that's it. Taxes, taxes, taxes. All the rest is bullshit, in my opinion.
Those are the real criminals, he says. Not the disabled, the poor, those of us struggling with mental health after decades of barely surviving. But the wealthiest among us, Ebenezer scrooging their way through life, hoarding billions, while the rest of us fight over scraps. Tax the rich, he says. Tax corporations. Because there's no ghost of Christmas past coming to scare them into giving it away anytime soon. In Canada, recent reports estimate corporations have kept around $25 billion out of our public funds by sheltering their wealth in offshore accounts each year. And wealthy citizens committing tax evasion has cost this country up to $3 billion a year. A 2019 report from the Parliamentary Budget Office found that nearly $1 trillion flowed from Canadian corporations into offshore tax havens such as Bermuda and the Cayman Islands between 2016 and 2018. Critics say Canada's tax rules allow this to happen and fail to criminalize tax avoidance. This is what Bregman was talking about in Davos, as politicians argue over how to pay for clean drinking water in First Nations communities, how to pay for emergency benefits during a pandemic, and whether people with disabilities deserve a dignified, livable income. There are yachtfuls of missed fiscal opportunities floating away in the Cayman Islands. Instead of butting heads over pennies, he says, it's time to tax the rich and fund guaranteed universal income. Bregman's now known for saying these ideas out loud, but these are not new ideas. We can see it in the works of 18th century English philosopher Thomas Paine, who proposed land and estate taxes that would be used to fund guaranteed income for elderly and disabled. He faced an uphill battle, convincing people that the difference between rich and poor wasn't decided through divine intervention, but that it was systemic and discriminatory in nature. And Martin Luther King Jr. argued the economic plight of Black Americans was a mechanism of ongoing oppression.
Now, one of the answers, it seems to me, is a guaranteed annual income, a guaranteed minimum income for all people and for all families of our country. It seems to me that the civil rights movement must now begin to organize for the guaranteed annual income, begin to organize people all over our country and mobilize forces so that we can bring to the attention of our nation this need and this something which I believe will go a long, long way toward dealing with the Negro's economic problem and the economic problem which many other poor people confront in our nation.
Even the right-leaning Nobel Prize-winning economist Milton Friedman was a proponent of what he called a negative income tax to help the poor. Friedman often argued for smaller government, but felt a guaranteed income for the poor was still the best way to eradicate poverty.
The proposal for a negative income tax is a proposal to help poor people by giving them money, which is what they need, rather than as now, by requiring them to come before a governmental official, detail all their assets and their liabilities, and be told that you may spend X dollars on rent, Y dollars on food, etc., and then be given a handout. The idea of the negative income tax is to treat people who are poor in the same way as we treat people who are rich.
For a long time, the major assumption that policymakers and the public have had is that poor people will misuse money, will waste it.
When I ask audiences, what would you do with a basic income? You. Like 99% of all people say, you know, I've got great ideas, ambitions, don't worry about me. It's the other people you should be worrying about, right? They'll waste it. So, yeah, we can have this discussion for a very long time, but I think it's just important to look at the evidence. There's been a huge World Bank study, for example, into cash transfers, unconditional cash transfers, where they give big amounts of money to very poor people. Alcohol consumption actually goes down. Tobacco consumption actually goes down.
Bregman took some important questions after his TED talk.
Fascinating. We got another question here I'd like to put from Mia. Says, let's say UBI gets applied on a global scale. Wouldn't inflation just go and basically all zero again?
On a global scale, well, these are much more utopian thinkers than I am. this is funnily one of the questions I get the most. If we would finance the basic income by just printing out money, then obviously the money supply will increase.
The amount of goods and services that we produce will not increase by that much, and we'll have massive inflation. Just look at Weimar Germany, right? We've seen that before. That's not what I'm arguing for. I'm saying that we should finance the basic income just in the way that we finance the welfare state right now, with taxes. Now, in the long run, I believe this will also actually help us to reduce a lot of government spending in other levels, you know, in other respects, you know, less spending on healthcare, crime, police, etc.
And as Bregman is out there looking for solutions, writing books and researching poverty, he comes across one study that took place right here in Canada nearly 50 years ago. Back in 1974, it was a Liberal Canadian government under Prime Minister Pierre Elliott Trudeau that funded the experiment involving Milton Friedman's negative income tax ideas. For 4 years, the Manitoba government and federal Liberals funded MINCOM. Its name is kind of a mishmash of minimum and income, but it was officially called the Manitoba Basic Annual Income Experiment. MINCOM took low-income people from three areas in Manitoba, including a smattering across the city of Winnipeg and a sampling of rural Manitobans, but researchers set up a so-called saturation zone in the town of Dauphin.
People in Dauphin had not only become richer, but also smarter and healthier.
For 4 years, people in Dauphin were given a chance to break free from poverty. But in 1979, Pierre Elliott Trudeau and the Liberals lost an election to Joe Clark and the Progressive Conservatives. The MINCOM experiment was shut down, the data buried.
And then Evelyn Forget, a Canadian professor, found the records. And for 3 years, she subjected the data to all manner of statistical analysis. And no matter what she tried, the results were the same every time. The experiment had been a resounding success.
Forget wanted to speak with us for this episode, but unfortunately didn't have the time. But she has spoken on the topic a number of times, like in this appearance on Ontario's public TV network, TVO, where she described some of the positive outcomes she discovered.
The actual hospitalizations in Dauphin relative to the control group fell by 8.5%, which is a massive amount. And a large portion of that was due to a reduction in mental health hospitalizations. And I think it has to do with the removal of stress from families.
She's an economist, professor at the Department of Community Health Sciences at the University of Manitoba, and the academic director at the Manitoba Data Research Centre. She also works with the Manitoba Centre for Health Policy and First Nations Centre for Aboriginal Health Research. She examined hordes of previously forgotten data from the experiment years after it was closed down.
The existence of an income insurance scheme goes a long way towards making people's lives just a little bit easier, a little bit more comfortable.
The data showed that people in Dauphin didn't stop working. They didn't quit their jobs or sit around drinking cocktails all afternoon on the taxpayer's dime. Women used the money to extend their maternity leaves.
One of the things we discovered was that there was an increase in high school completion among Dauphin subjects over the period of MINCOM. And if you think about a teenager, a 16-year-old, a 17-year-old, deciding whether to go back to school. Legally, they're able to leave school and to take a job. And we discovered by talking to some of the subjects that in low-income families, the boys especially, were under a fair amount of family pressure to become self-supporting as quickly as possible so that the family money could go to the younger siblings. When MINCOM came along, a lot of those families discovered that they could afford to support their sons in school a little bit longer. If you think about health, a lot of the accident and injury hospitalizations, for example, that would include things like car accidents. A lot of car accidents are alcohol-fueled. So it depends on the level of alcohol abuse in the community, and that depends on how many people are participating in the experiment, what income levels are.
Interesting. So if they had more income, they were less likely to be unfortunate social situations, therefore they might drive and drink less, and therefore fewer accidents?
Fewer industrial accidents, because they're under a little bit less pressure to stay in dangerous work situations. If you think about farms, they're maybe a little less desperate to get the harvest out of the field. You can also, accident and injury hospitalizations are also picking up the effects of family violence. And again, the lack of income is a key stressor for families, which may very well lead to poor outcomes for families.
MINCOM wasn't a standalone experiment, though. It was one of many of its time that showed people in poverty made better decisions when they weren't fighting to survive, and that investing in their future was good for the economy and federal budget. Now, nearly 50 years later, the federal Liberals have a guaranteed income bill on the table. Minister Carla Qualtro introduced that bill.
There are 6 million Canadians living with a disability. In 2017, nearly 850,000 working-age Canadians with disabilities lived in poverty, all with disabilities. And we know that the pandemic has made things worse and hit persons with disabilities much harder. I've no doubt that the number of Canadians with disabilities living in poverty has only increased during the past year. This is unacceptable. I'm very proud to say that earlier today, I introduced legislation to create the Canada Disability Benefit.
The bill only proposes a guaranteed income for people with disability, but critics of the Liberals and of this bill, including disability advocates and self-advocates, say, first of all, the timing couldn't have been worse. After showing just how rapidly it can move on legislation with the emergency response benefit and changes to medically assisted death laws, the Liberals seem to be dragging their feet on this one. It's been more than a year since the pandemic began, and the federal government is still offering only minimal additional supports to people with disability, like tax breaks and a one-time $600 injection that only some people qualified for. Then, all of a sudden, in June, the Liberals tabled this bill, C-35, the Canada Disability Benefit Act. It received its first reading in the House of Commons on June 22nd. The next day, the second session of the 43rd Parliament of Canada closed for the summer. There would be no debate, no need to respond to critics who said the bill lacked clarity or details, numbers, or clear promises that provincial health benefits and other federal assistance programs won't be clawed back when this comes into place. If this comes into place. Instead of feeling hope, a lot of Canadians with disability felt like they were being used in a political game. Parliament isn't scheduled to sit again until mid-September, and political watchers seem certain we're heading for an early federal election triggered by the government itself. This political posturing that seems to be going on is undermining how much faith people with disabilities are putting in Bill C-35.
My first feeling is like, I need access to being alive. I mean, yes, all those other accessibility things are great, but I'd like to be alive first. Can I have access to that? And so both federal and provincial, I mean, if you're looking at the universal basic income, well, duh. Like, I mean, it costs more to be disabled. If you're not even getting us up to minimum wage of what you think a healthy person needs to live on, then, you know, how is this a debate? And when you're PWD on assistance, it should be considered firmly in the land of health, you know, versus this, oh, well, you just pull yourself up from your boot by your bootstraps. It's like, with what magical health? You know, you're not giving me the supports to begin to support myself, like financial and medical. There's a whole bunch of magical thinking going on. So I don't know. I'll believe it when I see it.
However, Bill C-35 would be a completely unprecedented program at the federal level. Until now, federal assistance has been limited to hard-to-navigate disability tax breaks and tax-free savings programs. But for people like Madeline, who already doesn't qualify for existing tax breaks because she doesn't work, this anti-poverty legislation is already decades too late. As we navigate this post-pandemic world, it's clear there have been major shifts in social discourse around poverty and vulnerability. One thing that's becoming more widely accepted is that when people have to put all of their energy into surviving, they cannot thrive. And when people who are full of potential are struggling in poverty, dying in poverty, all of us suffer.
But also, you know, it's the whole, Oliver, you know, can I have some more, please? Like, you're starving the orphans, and now you're beating up the kid who doesn't want to starve. I'm not ungrateful. I am very grateful. And yet, this system is a slow death. It's a slow grind into deterioration and inevitable death. If you do not manage the issue, you cannot be surprised when the health issue amplifies and deteriorates.
We've come a long way since the era of Oliver Twist when it comes to our attitudes about supporting disability, but there's still a lot of ways modern policy and the politics around policy are working against people with disabilities, especially when it comes to post-viral syndromes like myalgic encephalomyelitis and chronic fatigue syndrome and long-haul COVID.
What a healthy person thinks fatigue is nothing. Like, there's no word for the exhaustion. It doesn't exist. Like, if you think you understand what tired is, you don't understand what mitochondrial failure fatigue is. And so then you don't understand what the supports need to be.
Madeline says her disease is one that's so misunderstood, it's not accounted for in the heavy bureaucracy that asks people with disabilities to prove their needs. She's falling through the cracks, and a basic income could help, but again, it's not going to be in place in time to save her life. In the absence of government help, Madeline has had to rely on the kindness of strangers to get her this far. She hasn't wanted to tell many people that she knows how sick she is, or that medically assisted dying feels like her only choice if she runs out of money. But the people she has told have donated here and there to help out. She's raised about $10,000 since November, which has kept her going until now. But that money has been mostly spent on treatments and essential basic living expenses over the last 8 months.
So somebody just today said, well, how much per month are you spending? And it's like, it doesn't work that way. It really depends on, you know, I'm flexing and bowing, I'm falling apart, I'm a little bit better, I'm able to lower certain supplements when I'm a little better, and then I have to raise them back up again. So I need physical supports, like I need my house cleaned, I need laundry done, I need pre-made meals with the special diet that they want you to do to make sure you're getting the highest nutrient content. But it also can't be so complex that it costs too much energy for the body to digest. You know, when the osteoarthritis couldn't be properly managed because I couldn't access what I needed, the minute I stopped walking, the fibro went absolutely through the roof, because at least the walking was stretching some of those muscles. But the cold hard fact is I needed every other area of energy that could be taken off my plate so that I could do the medically prescribed walk. I mean, what we really needed to do before I fell apart like this is have everything like that dealt with, so that I could be using my energy on the prescribed walk, on spending a little bit of time with friends.
Madeline is asking for the kind of help that would keep her living in the community, in her own home. And that's the direction governments in Canada have long been saying they support. A move away from institutionalization of people with illness and injury. A move away from publicly funded sort of poor houses for the sick that still exist across the country. If Madeline becomes sick enough to be institutionalized, she fears, and rightfully so, that care workers won't have the knowledge to prevent her from suffering immense pain and further debilitation. And she's probably right. Very few healthcare practitioners actually understand myalgic encephalomyelitis. So it would be difficult for people to understand the complex care that she's developed for herself over the years.
So I'm terrified of that measure of isolation. I know what it means to be trapped alone in a bed in a care home. And the more deteriorated I become, even the online communities become difficult for me to access, because I struggle more and more with reading and writing. Christmas time is when there's things going on that don't have to cost me energy, like cost me money. They cost me a lot of energy, but they don't have to cost me money per se, like house parties and stuff like that. I mean, I know, and everyone says, oh, don't buy me a present. But like, these are people who are doing massive things for me all year round, from rides to, you know, buying needed things that I need. Or so to not be able to just get them something, I started at least sort of growing. I grow rosemary for them. It's my Christmas present for them, you know, so at least it's something. But outside of that, I get to see them. I get to hear what's going on, even though it's financially super difficult. But more than that, I usually capsize myself during the Christmas season, because that emotional connection is so important. It helps tide me over, knowing that I was able to be a part of it. Because if you don't show up for anything ever, then you don't get to have friends. I call it friendship gardening.
With an open smile and with open doors, I will bid you welcome. What is mine is yours. With a glass raised to toast your health.
With a glass raised to toast your health.
And a promise to share the wealth.
Promise to share the wealth.
I will sail a friendly course, file a friendly charm. On a sea of love and a thankful heart.
We're not sure exactly what the next episode of I Am Madeline will sound like. We have an idea, and we're working to pull it off, but it puts a little bit of extra work on Madeline's plate, so please bear with us if it's not available in exactly 2 weeks' time. for now, I'll let you know that this is the final regular episode of I Am Madeline. Next time, you won't hear from Kelvin or I, just Madeline. Season one is coming to a close, and Kelvin and I have poured our hearts into this series, but now it's in your hands. Every like, share, and review of this podcast helps. Get out there and spread the word. It's time for change. We may pop in with extra episodes as things transpire in Madeline's life. If she manages to find a solution and avoid medically assisted death, we will be the first to let you know. But if that doesn't happen, we will be back to ensure that Madeline's fight has not been in vain, because she's not the only person dying of poverty with a lack of medical supports in a country that claims to have universal healthcare. And we will have bonus episodes coming out soon for our Patreon supporters. We owe you. So thank you to Fiona, our latest contributor. Later this week, I'm sitting down with Evelyn Forger, the woman who dug through the data from Dauphin, Manitoba, and who is still working to end poverty in Canada today. We'll talk about what she found in those piles of boxes of papers from the 1970s, and what she thinks of Bill C-35 and the government's handling of the social safety net during the pandemic. You can hear that bonus episode by signing up to support Umbrella Podcasting on Patreon. The money you send us is used to pay for editing software, equipment rentals, and transcription services. A transcribed version of each episode is available on our website, iammadeline.com, and we're on Twitter at iammadelinepod, where you can always reach out to us and find a link to Madeline's GoFundMe campaign. I Am Madeline is recorded and produced on the unceded lands of the Squamish, Musqueam, and Tsleil-Waututh people. All of the music you've heard throughout the season has come from Lee Rosevere. The show is co-produced by Kelvin Golley and me, Ash Kelly.